Be a part of the best pro wrestling podcast today by supporting the Going In Raw Patreon. You can enjoy access to the live taping of the show, exclusive merchandise, and patron-only episodes, and so much more. Support Going In Raw today. Click the link in the description.
This is Charlotte, and you're watching Going In Raw. That sounds terrible.
What's up? This is the most must-see WWE superstar of all time and his lovely, gorgeous wife.
Marie.
And you are going in SmackDown Live. Who needs Raw?
What's up? It's your girl, Sasha Banks, the legit boss, and you are watching Going In Raw.
Oh, baby, I like it raw. Oh, baby, I like it raw. And you are tuned in to Going In Raw right now. How you doing?
Hey, friendo, Steve here.
And Larson.
And welcome back to Going In Raw, the only pro wrestling podcast you need to be listening to right here at youtube.com/Steve and Larson. We're also available on the iTunes, on Podbean, Stitcher Radio, any place you can find podcasts. We're also available at SoundCloud, soundcloud.com/Steve and Larson. Pretty sure we're available at iHeartRadio and Google Play. I think I've seen us there. And we want to say thank you to everybody who hit that download button on the iTunes, subscribe. The review, they leave reviews and they rate us. I love looking at my phone, man, every day. Every day I
You're
get
obsessed.
Up.
Obsessed.
I check a couple things. I check our YouTube revenue because I like the money. And I check our iTunes rankings in the sports and recreation category. I like to see if we're above or below Ryback's podcast, Vince Russo's podcast, The Brand.
Yeah.
And to a lesser extent, X-Pac. I like to know where we rank in those areas.
Yeah.
Like, you know, Colt Cabana is a perfect example of a podcast. I'd like to be in his realm. And sometimes we're above him. Sometimes we're below him. I think he's like a weekly guy. We're three times a week.
So yeah.
I don't know how all that plays out. But I want to say thank you to everybody out there who's listening to the show. And, of course, thank you very much to our very special patrons over at patreon.com/Steven Larson. You can check out a live stream of the show every week.
Yeah.
A bunch of Patreon shirts just went out to our $50 and up patrons. We got a couple of those guys, so big ups to you guys. My goodness gracious, this is a lot of money.
And then you can vote on the theme of Kayfabe Corner every week.
That's right. That's right. We have our trivia cards ready for whatever this segment's called at the end of this podcast.
Oh, yeah, we're still doing that.
Yeah, that's okay. That's one of my favorites because it's like it's no work. It's sure. You don't have to do any research. It's great. It's awesome.
Which right now sounds welcome because we're going on 9 hours of work right now.
Do you know what? That doesn't sound very impressive. You used to tell me, number one, work. A lot of it is just listening, watching wrestling, talking wrestling.
Still, we edit. We talk. Talking.
Talking is exhausting.
It is exhausting.
It is exhausting. No, I remember you used to tell me back in the early days of the M. When
yeah,
you used,
we used to
pull
work some long weeks.
Long weeks.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's work. And that's stuff that, like, you know, this is our passion right
now.
No, here.
I know. It doesn't mean I'm not enjoying myself, but I can still be tired.
We're allowed to be exhausted, right? Yeah, we do our fair share of business here. So, yeah, because we've got a big day tomorrow, we can't spill any of those beans until next week. But we have some really cool stuff to show you guys next week. And so we're doing our podcast, our second podcast in a day.
Yeah.
I don't think we've ever done this, have we? Two podcasts in one day? I think we were going to but we didn't.
I think we did when you went on vacation. We did our mock draft, I think, the same day as another podcast.
Okay.
That's the only other time
that
I
might have
think
been.
That we may have had to have done it.
Might have been the case. Yeah. Anyways. Fun times here at Going In Raw, though.
Yeah.
We watched SmackDown.
Together.
I like this. See, I like this two podcasts thing in a day. I'm sick right now.
Yeah.
I think I've been cured by hanging out with you and watching wrestling all day, Larson. No?
I have a hard time believing that's the case.
I have an easier time believing that than any of the weird herbal remedies you guys concoct up over there on the internet that you always tell me about. What was it? What did you say earlier today? Breathe in a mug with some ginger in it or something like that?
No.
Get some honey and breathe it in or something?
No.
What was it again?
It was...
It's a bunch of voodoo magic, man. Nobody's gonna
I haven't
do
gotten
that.
Sick yet.
Well, I took a swig of your Coke earlier, by the way.
Coke's water.
Yeah, that too. Let's talk about SmackDown.
SmackDown.
Right,
yeah. Yeah, all right.
What was that?
No, earlier.
Was that your new stinger?
No, a little bit ago, I combined all right and yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one to be clear with.
All right?
Saying. Yeah, and all right.
On what? This very show right here?
What?
On this show? Or like?
No, I just did. I was starting to say all right, and then I just said yeah in the middle saying all right. And then it's one to be clear that I was saying yeah and all right.
Yeah, all right. You said y'all right?
Yeah, all right. And then I said, oh,
yeah,
all
right.
Yeah.
All right, all right, all right.
All right, yeah.
Have you seen those new Matthew McConaughey commercials? The Lincoln commercials?
The one where he falls into the pool?
I love that commercial.
You know, we were watching something the other day, and they played that commercial literally 3 times in the span of 10 minutes.
I kind of want to buy a Lincoln at this point. I'll be honest with you.
Now you're just blowing smoke up my ass. Let's talk about SmackDown.
No, I'm not. I saw that commercial the other day. I was like, man, I wouldn't mind buying it.
You're usually not such a rube for marketing.
If that... aren't I? I feel like I'm the biggest rube for marketing.
Really?
Yeah. Bright, shiny colors, man. That's all I care about. That's true. SmackDown, Larson. Let's talk SmackDown.
Yeah, show opened with...
No, hold on. Look, I gotta get this off my chest.
What?
I'm not the quickest man in the world, but I'm not stupid.
Okay.
You know, it's going to be good if I start with that.
Okay.
Everybody on our Twitter has been singing the praise of SmackDown. SmackDown's better. SmackDown's better.
I haven't been quite saying that, but I've been saying SmackDown for the last couple weeks has been the more enjoyable show.
I think I'm finally turning that corner where SmackDown now feels as important as Raw.
Mm-hmm.
I really do.
What did I tell you earlier today? I said, Raw is a show I feel obligated to watch. SmackDown is a show I look forward to watching.
Right. However, I think I'm turning to the point where SmackDown I feel obligated to watch.
No, obligation isn't for me. The way the context in which I mean it isn't like I have to watch it because I'm eager to see it.
No, I know what you mean. I understand what you mean.
Because it's an obligation. I have to watch it so we can do content on it.
Three things have sort of turned me around. Number one, and this is like we talk about this kind of business quite a bit, but the view numbers on SmackDown and the audio numbers on SmackDown on our show. Last week, SmackDown beat Raw.
Yeah.
So more people evidently gave a shit about SmackDown. Now, so we can know.
Maybe that's actually the better metric to determine who's winning this brand split.
Yeah.
Not ratings, but our view numbers.
I think you're right. And right now, the view numbers on our audio podcast are neck and neck. Neck and neck. On the YouTube version of the shows, SmackDown won handedly last week.
Yeah.
It feels to me, there are several factors here. Number one, AJ Styles is world champion.
Yeah.
Feels so much weightier
yes.
than Dean Ambrose did.
Yes.
Even
tonight when AJ was barely on the show.
Tonight was the perfect example through and through. And we'll go through this. Let's just start at the beginning.
Yeah. Daniel Bryan came out and moderated a contract signing.
Yeah.
For the women's title match at No Mercy.
I love how Daniel Bryan plays with the crowd, too. Because they started saying, we're going to keep things civil here. And they started booing. He said, don't boo that. He's such an amiable fella.
He's comfortable.
He's so comfortable. And he has a true, legit rapport with the entire arena.
Yeah.
That's insane, if you think about it. That's really insane. Like, you know how, like, a really good stand-up can command a room?
Yeah.
You know, like, Richard Pryor, Eddie Murphy
can
command a room? He's the same way.
Yeah.
He can command an arena.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he comes out. He says, I know these contract signings have a tendency to kind of get out of hand. We're not going to let that happen here on SmackDown. And that's when the crowd
When the boos happen, yeah.
So Becky comes out, talks for a bit.
Mm-hmm.
Alexa Bliss comes out. They go back and forth.
Within 2 seconds of Alexa Bliss coming out, we got more. You know, and that's one of the negatives that I can say about SmackDown is that their commentary team feels so amateur rank. Bush League compared to Raw's because I love Corey Graves and his banter with both Michael Cole and Byron Saxon. I think they are so fucking top notch.
Yeah.
Mauro Ranallo, the Harley Quinn of SmackDown. Why? What, really? What? Because she has her tips dyed now? I mean, is that the lone, like, she kind of dolls up like her at one pay-per-view?
Yeah.
And now she's the Harley Quinn of the, I can't stand that stuff.
Yeah.
Can't stand it. Anyways, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Anyways. So, Alexa and Becky, they talk. And it's actually really good. Becky actually delivered a really good promo about how Alexa said, you know, you weren't, I think she said, born to be a champion.
You're
like
born to be the person who lives up and then fails.
Yeah, but then Becky says, no, I may not have been born to be champion, but I worked my way to being champion.
Right.
It was good.
No, I liked it. Alexa Bliss is really good. On Talking Smack last week, she was really, really good. Becky's really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
They're both really, really good.
And that crowd was hot for Becky. They were chanting her name.
And
it was great.
The great thing. Oh, yeah, she's huge. The great thing is Alexa Bliss is such a... There is such an element of... Throw her in the deep end because you know she can swim. We just want everybody to see that.
Yeah.
Whereas Dana Brooke, on the flip side, on Raw, was throwing the deep end, and let's see what she can do. And she kind of drowns sometimes, and sometimes she kind of swims. But Alexa Bliss, it's like, we know you're ready.
Yeah.
Just get out there. That's why she didn't have another year in NXT,
yeah.
because they knew she was ready.
Yeah.
And how great is it that their women's division, they can... That is the conundrum. And we've got this before. People saying, oh, the women's division on SmackDown is better. And it is better in the respect that you can plug so many of these different pieces in. And that's the conundrum we're seeing on Raw is Bayley needs to be protected. Sasha needs to be protected. Charlotte needs to be protected. And Nia Jax needs to be protected. And right now, Emma's not there and Paige isn't there. And Dana Brooke can job. But those are three people versus four people that have to be protected by
yeah.
and large.
Yeah.
So you don't get the level of unpredictability that we need.
On SmackDown, by and large, they've done a great job of building up all the women to be roughly on the same level.
You can't name
everyone's a viable
You cannot
threat.
Name a jobber.
No.
You can't name a jobber.
No.
So yeah, that was a good bit. We go to Daniel Bryan backstage. He encounters The Miz. Miz says, I don't want to do my Intercontinental match today. Daniel Bryan says, well, we renegotiated your contract. So, and it says that you have to do that. So you're going to do that.
And if you don't defend your title, then contract's canceled.
Exactly.
So I assume they're setting this all up. So eventually The Miz will not defend his title. Therefore his contract will be voided and therefore he will be a free agent. If that's the case, if rumors are true that Miz might find his way to Raw at some point.
I still hope not.
No, I hope not.
Yeah. He has really benefited quite a bit. That's why I'd be really, really surprised if they did bring him over to Raw. I'd be really surprised at that.
Yeah, I would too.
Just wouldn't make a lot of sense.
I mean, he is one of the cornerstones of SmackDown.
Mm-hmm.
And he's done a really great job on the show.
Yeah, he has.
It'd be a bummer to see him leave.
Yeah. Let's see here. The Usos, man, talk about a freaking turnaround.
Yeah.
Honestly, I'm not lying to you. Okay, so Usos took on American Alpha, told a great story in the ring.
It was a fantastic match.
It was a fantastic match. There was this element of Chad Gable, he's coming out, you know, he's fresh off a knee injury. At one point during the match, he injures his knee again.
Yeah.
He's looking for the tag, for the hot tag, and Jordan says no.
Yeah,
because I don't know if I've seen that before.
No, I don't know either. Because like the Usos had worked over Gable's knee the entire match.
Yeah,
like every time Gable was in the ring, his knee got beat up.
Yeah,
when he was outside the ring, his knee got beat up.
Yeah.
So when Jordan had the opportunity to tag him in, he's like, "Dude, you got one leg right
now."
Yeah,
exactly. Like that level of tag relationship, you don't see a lot of. They don't give them opportunities to do that. You don't see a lot of that.
Yeah. It's great storytelling.
Really good storytelling. I do think that, you know, when they were cutting their promo beforehand on the Usos, still a little too much. I understand that there's energy and enthusiasm there, but they need to understand how to release that energy and enthusiasm.
And there's gotta be
because when you're just screaming at the mic, it just doesn't work as well.
There's gotta be some dynamics to the promo. It's got to have ups and downs.
Exactly.
Flow. They can't just all be turned up to 11.
Right, exactly.
Shift and change volumes.
I always bring up this comparison as a constructive criticism, not as, oh, I'm bitching about American Alpha. But when I think of the Revival, they know how to cut a promo with many layers to it.
Yeah.
And American Alpha, so far they don't. Or if they do, we haven't seen it.
Yeah.
So
I think we saw him do it in NXT.
Oh, no, that's the thing. We've seen him do it in NXT.
They can do it.
At a certain level, I'm just not sure where their characters are supposed to be right now. They don't entirely understand how to convey that yet.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I mean, that's reps. That's reps.
Tonight,
6 months from now, they'll probably be
pros. Tonight, at least, they showed intensity.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You know, that's really... Granted, this is on my mind because we talked about it earlier today when we did the Raw recap of going in Raw.
Yeah.
And my main criticism of the entire episode of Raw this week was a general lack of intensity.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, I mentioned Rollins quite a bit. But just the whole show seemed to lack urgency and intensity.
Yeah.
Considering it was the go-home show for Clash of Champions. SmackDown felt like an intense show.
It did, yeah.
Matches
it totally
had stakes.
Did.
For example, this tag match was for the number one contendership for the tag title. So the winner of that match would face Slater and Rhino at No Mercy.
Right.
There's stakes.
Yeah.
That one match had more stakes than I think anything else on Raw did.
Yeah, I know. I know. Okay, let's talk about the Usos really quick. I have gone 180
Same
degrees
here.
They on
are
the Usos.
Fantastic
okay,
heels.
Here's the thing, dude. When they were backstage after the match, because Usos went over, when they went backstage and started threatening Slater and Rhino, which was in while Slater, so it showed Slater and Rhino backstage watching and they were doing a little comedic bit.
Yeah,
but it was an understated comedic bit. It wasn't over the top. And how great is Heath Slater? You know, I finally pinned down what his comedic sort of timing reminds me of. It reminds me of Kenny Powers, Danny McBride.
Yeah.
He has the same cadence almost with some of what he says.
Yeah, I can see that.
And he's got the same kind of, like when Danny McBride goes sort of not as obnoxious, he's got that thing. And that's what makes me really laugh about it. It echoes that. Although Danny McBride's shit got kind of old for me really quick.
Yeah.
But
Rhino was doing great.
And Rhino was doing too. Great. Just fantastic. So the Usos come back there, and I swear to you, and this might be overstating it a bit, so I'm going to try to temper it.
Okay.
They reminded me of the freaking Briscoes. That level of, oh man, these guys are kind of scary. These guys are legitimately kind of scary. Like, they have made me completely forget their entire smiling babyface thing. They really have. And it's like, it's not just the intensity in the ring, because I always thought they had a fair amount of intensity in the ring.
Yeah.
But man, I mean, the grills, and it's not, dude, they're not even being cartoonishly heel.
No.
They seem scary.
Yeah.
And the Briscoes, when you see their promos, you don't want to be alone with those guys. They're terrifying. And the Usos aren't that level of terrifying, because when you're in New Japan or Ring of Honor, you can take that intensity notch up a level. Like when Omega won the client, I showed you the press conference, he's dropping F-bombs left and right.
Yeah.
You can't do that in WWE, so you can only go so far. But it wouldn't have surprised me if during their match with American Alpha, somebody pulled out a shank and, you know, or a shiv and shank somebody. That's what I wanted to see. So anyways, I am hugely impressed. And the Usos seem like this is the role that they need to have. They've been heels before.
Yeah.
But still dressed in babyface.
Yeah, this is the, as long as I can remember, the first time they've done kind of like a complete reinvention.
Yeah.
I mean, we noticed today that their Titantron package had changed.
Yeah, yeah.
They've hit a home run so far with it.
This brings some weight to that tag division in a matter of 2 weeks.
Yep.
Very impressed with the Usos. I'm really looking forward to seeing what else they can do. Let's see here. Apollo Crews and Baron Corbin had a match. They are booking Baron so strong.
Yeah.
And I am impressed because, I'm sorry, you might disagree with me on this, but he comes off in my eyes as legit.
He does, if for no other reason than he's a large guy.
When you were sitting here doing some work as the match was happening.
Oh, you're talking about the spot where he was destroying Apollo Crews' head?
And Crews had his head down on the barrier.
And that's what I said. I was like, geez.
You looked up and went, you were offended. You were like, oh my God, that's a level of violence that we shouldn't be seeing right now in the WWE.
Well, it's a level of violence we don't often see in the WWE.
I know, exactly.
Because they looked stiff.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy. So there were a couple of moments like that, but they booked him. I mean, this second match in a row when he's absolutely destroyed Apollo Crews, just destroyed him. Which says one thing about Baron Corbin and the exact opposite thing about Apollo Crews. You know, they have a high ceiling for Baron Corbin in terms of, in their eyes.
Well, I told you during the match that whenever John Cena gets the belt off AJ, they need a heel for him to square off against.
Yeah.
I'm guessing Baron Corbin will eventually at some point be that guy.
Yeah. Yeah, I could see that. I could totally see
sometime that. Sometime next year after WrestleMania.
I mean, somebody on Twitter was saying, you know, wow, I can see him in an IC title run coming up. And I was like, I can see them doing that unpredictable shit where he gets a world title run.
Maybe a brief one.
Maybe a brief run. Maybe even just a shot at the world title or a program where he doesn't win it, but he's up there. Because I think they have that level of confidence
in him. If it's going to happen within next year, I think he'll be in a program with Cena or some other top babyface for the title.
Yeah.
Not win it, but being a 1 or 2 month
program. But I can even see after Dean's done not winning the world title this time, he can drop down into a program with Baron, and then Baron either gets past him or he doesn't. But, man, they're booking him so strong. And I'm believing it because they're letting him do that big guy, I'm going to destroy you type thing.
Yeah.
But it's not like a stupid Ryback big guy, you know, stupid.
It's stiff.
It hurts. And
he's
so – say what you will about Baron Corbin – he's in his character.
I think he is his character.
Well, yeah, but, you know, people like that don't actually go around. He's probably a bit mellower than that. But, you know, and look, if it's because he can't stretch, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But he does a really good job at that character.
Yeah.
So, let's see here. What else do we have? We had, oh, yeah, Jack Swagger was on commentary.
I don't remember him saying much.
Jack Swagger was on commentary. He was utterly uninteresting. And then he legitimately looked scared when Corbin confronted him, too. I'm not really sure that was the emotion he was supposed to be giving off. I'm not sure that was the vibe Jack Swagger should have been giving off. I think he looked legitimately scared by Baron Corbin.
Maybe.
I think he might have been. I mean, he's like, oh, man.
Like I said, the level of violence is something we don't usually see in WWE. Maybe it took Jack Swagger by surprise, too.
He's like, oh, man, they just buried Apollo Crews like that? And I'm like a couple levels below Apollo Crews. They're going to bury the crap out of me.
Oh, yeah. There's zero chance Jack Swagger wins any match against Baron Corbin.
Jack Swagger's going to be lucky if he comes out of this alive. Oh, let's see here. Dean backstage shadowboxing or something?
He was just standing behind a fence.
Yeah. Anyways. Naomi and Nikki gave an interview.
That was a good interview.
It was good. It was good. I see, this is the thing. Again, the difference between Raw and SmackDown this week. Every backstage segment felt like it added to the thread of the show.
And you know what else it felt like? It's not as scripted.
Yeah, you're right.
They felt off the cuff.
Yeah.
Not so scripted.
Yeah. There was one thing that I thought felt a little bit scripted, and it was AJ when he gave the definition of rivalry.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I felt that was too writer-ish.
A little bit.
Maybe if it was just him, then good on him. It felt too writer-ish.
Yeah. But by and large, all the promos, which I'm sure were scripted.
Speaking of writer, we didn't see the Hype Bros, did we? The Hype Bro, sorry.
Hype Bro. But all the backstage stuff felt really loose.
It felt loose, and it felt like it belonged in the show.
Yeah.
Dolph Ziggler gave an interview. Nowadays, whenever I see Dolph Ziggler, I can't not think of the Colonel.
Yeah.
World, what does it say? World's strongest chicken. We'll see about that. And then he just shows up in the chicken's kitchen. Why is the chicken even there?
Rips his shirt off.
That was great. And you're like, man, Will Forte is built.
Oh, wait, that's Dolph Ziggler.
No, wait, that's Dolph Ziggler. That's right. I'm like, yeah, idiot. Stupid idiot. Let's see here. Then speaking of the Colonel versus the Chicken, we have Dolph versus the Miz.
We went to Del Taco during this match, though.
We actually went to Del Taco during this match. We'll watch it tomorrow. Everybody on Twitter is at RealGoingInRaw, where we live tweet from, said it was a hell of a match. I did watch the Twitter highlights, and Dolph. Maurice was ejected, but Dolph had his little handy can of spray.
Miz
had his little handy can of spray. Got Dolph right in the eyeballs, so the Chicken won this time.
I wonder...
you think we're going to see a blow-off at No Mercy?
Yeah.
I mean, technically it should have been a blow-off because, you know...
What, tonight?
It should have been, because this is two in a row. It should have been the last
one.
Yeah,
but it's not really a blow-off unless there's a clean winner.
Really?
Typically.
Miz got the pin.
Yeah, I know, but yeah. He's used nefarious means to achieve...
CM Punk went 400-plus days using nefarious means.
Well, not all that run was a heel run, though.
Yeah, like half it was. Let's see here. Yeah, no, I'm thinking No Mercy. We're going to get the last one. You think Dolph wins it then?
If he does.
You think Miz goes to Raw?
Yeah.
That's a bummer. I hope not. Or does Miz go up to Dean Ambrose? I don't know. Dean Ambrose, there's like three people that are just waiting for Dean Ambrose. Baron Corbin's one of them. The Miz is probably one of them. And then what's another heel? That might be it. Just those two guys. Has to be one of those two guys.
Yeah.
Randy Orton versus Eric Owen. We figured this would be the debut of Luke Harper. The re-debut of Luke Harper.
We were wrong.
The return of Luke Harper.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were wrong.
That might happen at No Mercy. We might get to see that too.
Orton beat Eric Rowan in a squash match, basically.
Yeah.
And then the lights went out and Eric Rowan had just disappeared.
Yeah, and his mask was in the ring.
Yeah.
And then cut to Bray.
Bray did some promo.
A promo.
I didn't really pay attention to
this. I didn't. I kind of thought I had an idea where it was going, so I just kind of checked out.
Then we had a tag match. Nikki and Naomi versus Carmella. Carmella! The Natty!
This one was a no contest, I believe, because Carmella attacked Nikki before the match started.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, they rang the bell. That's right.
So they just brawled.
Yeah. I like this, man. I'm fine with that. I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
I'd actually kind of prefer a match to get thrown out and get straight to the point. That's what SmackDown does. It kind of gets straight to the point.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like it.
Yeah, me too.
We got to see AJ polishing his belt, and then he did an interview with the robot interview lady.
Mm-hmm.
And then when it was done, she went... She shut down. We had Dean Ambrose versus Juan Cena. Don't laugh at that. It's not funny.
Why?
Juan Cena. Oh, man. Decent enough match. Dean went over cleanly.
Yeah, that was surprising. Cleanly. He rolled him up for the win.
He needed that, man.
Yeah.
You got to start booking. You can't have Cena be Superman all the time.
Nope.
You got to have this triple threat has to have. Now, I'm relatively sure AJ's going to want to keep the world title.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, because I think I read today on WrestleZone that Cena's slated for another break to go shoot American Grit.
Yeah.
Starting the SmackDown after No Mercy.
But Dean has to look strong.
Yeah.
He has to look strong because he's going to be the replacement big babyface when John Cena leaves. So once Cena's gone, somebody steps up to AJ's world title. And if it's not Dean, because Dean already went through that.
It's going to be Randy Orton.
Oh, man. Well, he'll be a jobber to the stars. He's going to get a win over Bray.
Yeah, and then he'll go into a program with AJ and lose.
I'm fine with that. I'm okay with that. Just wish it would. Yeah, I don't know.
It'll probably be.
What are you going to do?
After No Mercy, it'll probably be AJ Dean at Survivor Series, maybe.
World title.
And then maybe against Randy at, what's the December pay-per-view?
Worldtitle.com.
Not TLC. Is it Roadblock? Roadblock, I guess.
Roadblock. No, Roadblock. And Roadblock is right before Mania.
No, they changed it.
Did they change it?
It's in December now.
Okay.
It's Roadblock and TLC are in December.
I have no idea.
And then Rumble, maybe it'll be Orton and...
All I know is that at WrestleMania 33, Baron Corbin's winning the world title.
No way that's ever going to happen.
You watch. Watch how they book him. Watch how they book him.
Maybe at WrestleMania 36.
He's a beast.
You want to answer some questions?
Look, Ty Dillinger's going to be in 2K17.
That's great.
He's so great. Excited about that. This is great.
Ty Dillinger
is he going to be naked as well? Can I see his perfect 10 inches? Ew, gross, Larson. You're gross.
Do you want to answer some questions?
So gross.
Do you want to answer some questions?
Hold on a second.
What?
Yes.
Really?
Let's see if we got blocked. Oh no, Morrow, don't block us.
Wait, what was his response?
He said, He's awkward as your stupid pole. I think we just got blocked by Morrow. Oh no, I got blocked by Morrow. Yeah, I know, but look, I get the final win. Look at how many people voted in our poll. Look at that. 524 votes. Morrow, jokes. They're all jokes. Everybody tweet at Morrow Ranello. Tell him we were just joking. What are odds Morrow Ranello makes an awkward Brangelina reference? That's just gentle ribbing.
Yeah.
That's some gentle ribbing, Morrow. He said awkward as your stupid poll. Twitter troglodyte. Hashtag Twitter troglodyte. Hashtag bye, Felicia. That's relevant. That's so perfect. He used a terrible pop culture reference to block us. Well done, Morrow. You win.
All right. You want to answer some questions?
Yeah, why not?
Kyle Ulysses, is there any possibility that AJ will lose the title at No Mercy? I mean, there's always a possibility, but not a very large one.
Yeah, there's a possibility.
Ain't going to happen, though. He's going to win.
No, there's no possibility. No.
The now 29-time European champion.
Like seven at best.
How long do you see Rhino and Heath holding the tag straps? Personally, the 29-time European champion feels like they will drop the belts to the Usos at No Mercy. Maybe.
The way the Usos are going, that's a distinct possibility. The
Usos are great.
Terrifying.
James Rodriguez, do you think SmackDown Live is on equal footing as Raw? If not, what are they missing? Yeah, they're on equal footing, and seems like most weeks they just zoom right past Raw.
Well, I'm not going to go that far yet. I'm not saying most weeks.
Last 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Raw has won. It had the advantage 1 week. I think SmackDown had the advantage the other two.
SmackDown's definitely been better this week.
Yeah, last 2 weeks. Alex Cartwright, since the Usos are doing the whole work a limb thing on SmackDown, are the Revivals set for Raw when they get their call-up? The work a limb thing is not an exclusive property of any one act.
Mm-hmm.
Several wrestlers, most wrestlers have worked a limb.
Yeah.
That's just kind of wrestling 101, I think.
Yeah, pretty much. Are the Revivals set for Raw? No, I don't think.
I hope not. They'd be great on SmackDown.
I don't know. The Usos, the way they are, I don't know. Another mega strong heel team. I could see why he's saying that.
No,
it's
I
possible.
Understand.
But then you have some. You know, you got the club there. Yeah. And they're kind of the. So yeah, I don't know.
But the Revival are different in that they're a, kind of a throwback team.
That's true.
TJ Kinder, matches you are most looking forward to heading into No Mercy. He is looking forward to Alexa versus Becky and to see where AJ versus Cena versus Ambrose goes.
What am I?
Hold on a second.
Go ahead and answer the question.
Okay. I don't know. Like, a part of me wants to say Miz versus Dolph. Kind of interested to see how all that's going to play out.
Yeah.
Because I kind of know that. I mean, look, AJ, Cena, Dean's going to be a hell of a match.
But AJ is going to retain. I'm kind of interested to see how the Usos, Heath, and Rhino match plays out.
Yeah. Considering they did lose to them.
Yeah.
So maybe with this new attitude.
Exactly.
I don't feel comfortable doing the Morrow voice now. He blocked me. What the heck? Doesn't he know we're very positive people? We shouldn't be blocked.
I don't know.
I blocked you. Block party.
What's happened?
Block party. Sorry.
Jefferson. How do you get off Twitter, man? We're trying to do a show.
Oh no.
Come on.
I can do both. I do both all the time.
I know people complain about it in the comments.
Really?
Yes.
They say that?
Yeah, say, why is that guy on his phone while he's trying to do a podcast?
Nobody says that.
Yes, they do.
Somebody named Rand Marson.
I don't comment in our own videos.
Oh, yes. Why is that guy on Twitter? Block party.
People say bye, Felicia.
Bye, Felicia. Twitter troglodyte.
Jefferson, how do you fix Jack's swagger?
Hashtag no more O for you. How do I fix Jack's swagger?
Well, first of all, he shouldn't look like he's scared of Baron Corbin.
He shouldn't look scared of Baron Corbin, exactly.
Nope.
He shouldn't get an anxiety erection every time Baron Corbin comes within 10 feet of him. I tweeted that out, too. I said, Jack Swagger looks like he has an anxiety erection.
Did you tag?
I didn't tag Morrow.
Did you tag Jack Swagger in it?
No, I don't want to get blocked by him, too.
Okay. Okay.
Boy, I learned my lesson. Block party.
Any other ideas of how to fix Jack's swagger?
Oh, man. No, look, his promo last week sunk him in the ground. His promo last week was weird and horrible, and it sunk him into the ground.
Yeah.
So I don't know what to do with him. I mean, at his best, he was one of the guys who really benefited from having a mouthpiece, from having Zeb Coulter with him.
Yes.
He really did, because that was when he was at his best.
Yeah.
And you go along those lines, you know. They should still be trying their best to skewer the American political system, you know. Mm. I mean, look, I'm not saying they should, but there's some room for satire there, I guess.
Oh, there is. This, you know, historically, they really had
historically
done the best results when they tried to do that.
Yeah. Next.
Carlos Hackworth. Hey, friendos.
Hey.
What are the odds that Dean Ambrose gets buried after No Mercy?
None. He might not be in the world title scene, but that doesn't mean he's going to get buried.
Yeah.
You know, I think they'll still book him. They're booking him super strong now. So.
Daniel Gannon. Do you think a Dean Ambrose John Cena feud is best for business and why?
Dean Ambrose.
I think it would be. Like after Cena and AJ have their thing, get Dean back in there. I think that'd be good.
A Dean Ambrose Cena, but Cena's leaving.
I know, that's why I said after Cena and AJ do their thing.
After Cena and AJ, Cena leaving?
No, yeah. After No Mercy. But I'm talking about after
Cena gets back.
Yeah.
Get him in there with Dino.
Yeah.
I don't know. I kind of want Dino with, like, younger people, other people. Baron Corbin.
Okay.
No good?
No, it's fine. The thing.
Cena versus Corbin.
That'll probably happen eventually, too. I just said that earlier. I said when Cena gets the belt back, I wouldn't be surprised if he gets in a program with Corbin for a month or two.
Yes. Next.
Andrew Wormley.
Yes.
Hey, friendos. How would you rebook Apollo Crews?
Oh man, jeez, I don't know. Have him start smiling again because he was winning at least then, kind of. Oh man, I don't know. Well, he dropped the F-bomb tonight on SmackDown apparently.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe do that. Maybe just have him curse a lot.
Okay.
I don't know where to go with Apollo Crews. What you tell me?
I think your idea of him being kind of a tweener.
Yeah.
Like he knows he's better than everybody.
Yeah, I always like that too.
I think that's a good way to go with him.
He needs
that way he could be kind of heelish, and then if he is entertaining at that, it'll get him over eventually as a face.
Just give him a string of wins. I mean, you got to bring in. He can't bring in jobbers, but okay. Who can he beat? And the status quo hasn't really changed that much. He can beat Kalisto.
Mm-hmm.
He can beat. Hell, him and Kalisto can have a couple matches. Can have a little bit of a feud, and they can put on some really good matches. Yeah. He can beat Jack Swagger now that he's there.
Yeah.
He can beat
Zack Ryder.
That's a pretty big win. Mojo Rawley. I'm sorry.
Zack Ryder.
Yeah, Zack Ryder. Hell, break up the Vaudevillains. Have them job to him. I don't know. Have him win against a bunch of people.
Mm-hmm.
Have him win against a bunch of people. Yeah. Have him put on very, very impressive matches.
Yes.
Tell the other people to make him look good.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're building a superstar out of him.
Yes.
And then, of course, you'd put him in like a cowboy gimmick.
Five-time
I looked at Magnum TA over there and he threw me off.
All right.
Yes!
I guess six-time Intercontinental champion.
You have no enthusiasm for this Intercontinental champion. The European champion you're all about.
Yeah.
What's the deal with that? Yes.
Because the European champion, the 29-time European champion, this is his gimmick.
Yeah. Block party.
Hey, Fredo, that's the champ.
You know, when we're driving to where we're driving tomorrow, the entire time I'm going to be doing that.
I know.
Block party.
Hey, Fredo, it's the champ who puts a stamp on going in Raw.
Oh, I like that. Okay. I'm on his team now.
At least he's got a catchphrase.
That's six-time Intercontinental. I'm swerving European. I'm all in on this IC champ.
Okay.
Yes.
Question.
Block party.
Why do you think Apollo Crews is getting buried?
Like Brangelina.
He hasn't won since his number one contender triple threat.
Arby's.
Do you think he was brought up too early?
Or Harley Quinn. Think
he's the Vaudevillains of the singles division? I think he was brought up too early.
Movie reference. Yeah, he's brought up too early. We knew that going into it. When, as soon as he came up, we're like, really? It's not that time yet. Time for him to go back to NXT.
Yeah, he's probably brought
Shouldn't
up
too early.
But even then, you know, they got to give him something to do. He just doesn't have anything to do.
Yeah, that's not an excuse. Being brought up too early isn't an excuse for them giving him nothing to do.
What?
The fact that he came up too early is no excuse for them giving him nothing to do.
No, I agree. That's what I just said.
That's what I just said.
Yeah, that's what I just said, too. Eric Hobson. How would you book a Necro Butcher New Jack program on the current SmackDown?
You can't. Can't do it. Block party. Can't do it.
Gosh, this is going to get so annoying.
It's not my fault. It's Mauro's fault. He blocked us.
Well, it's your fault that you keep repeating block party. That's your fault, because nowhere in his tweet did he use the words block party.
I think I've heard him say it before.
Get over it. You're blocked.
I'm off Twitter. We're blocked.
We're blocked.
Rail going in around. Why was I following him anyways? Wait, was I following him? I don't even know if I was following him.
Now you can't tell.
I don't even know. I'm going to tweet at him from the MF Steve here one. Be like, Mauro was a joke.
He'll block you there, too.
He was like, block party. Your joke's not funny.
Brady Ogden.
Your poll's awkward. 500 people don't think it's awkward, Mauro.
Oh, goodness. Brady Ogden. I know you guys became a wrestling-only channel, but is there any chance you will do the return of Robin Stevens in NBA 2K17? It's right there. Steve's grabbing it right now. We have it.
Party.
We'll do it soon.
Yeah, well, for sure we'll do it. Right there, Robin Stevens.
Jason the Cabbie.
I love Jason the Cabbie.
With Halloween.
He needs to submit video questions every week.
With Halloween and development of his own podcast about bad horror movies just around the corner, what are some of your favorite scary movies, good, bad, but fun to laugh at, starring the men and women of the squared circle?
It always has to come back around to wrestling. Can't you guys ever ask us, just what's your favorite scary movies?
Yeah, The Haunting.
But I will say this. I will say this. Kind of a creepy movie. They Live, starring Roddy Piper.
Yeah.
Creepy movie.
Yeah.
The design of that movie is immaculate. It's so great. I mean, that's why Shepherd Fairey ripped it off.
Yeah.
Because it was amazing.
Yeah, that's John Carpenter.
Yeah. Good stuff.
Yeah. Charles Falk.
Yes.
I hear people talk about moving someone down or back to NXT. Is that even possible? It is. Zack Ryder went down to NXT. inform the hype bro.
Yeah, but you know what? That's a very, very specific situation that I just don't know if that's going to happen again.
Oh, I don't know if it will either, but it has happened. There's precedent for it.
There is precedent there. You missed out Lord Craigslesworth Esquire.
Oh, I'm sorry, Lord Craigslesworth Esquire III. Hey, friendos.
Block party!
With me. Jeez Louise.
I only do it because it cracks you up.
Hey, friendos, with Miz retaining... I think you do it because it cracks you up.
Well, that's the end.
With Miz retaining with cheap tactics once again.
You're not
again,
discouraging me.
Doesn't it just leave Ziggler and Miz in the same spot we have been multiple weeks in a row? It seems like putting Miz over clean or just making him drop the title to Ziggler would make the story advance in a much more satisfying manner. Anything but the same unknown substance to the eye shtick they seem to be using to be safe. I think they're trying to build up to their blow-off match at No Mercy.
I don't know. I kind of, I'll be honest, I was kind of disappointed with that finish tonight. The spray to the eyes thing.
Yeah.
I'm going to push until we see what happens next.
Exactly.
Because I am interested to see what happens next. I just feel like, yeah, 2 weeks in a row, it's kind of been the same thing. And that's the thing that I've been praising, that I've praised SmackDown for this week, is moving ahead, sense of urgency. This felt like it was lacking in that. Dolph came out and he was like, oh, I'm going to go win this thing. You know? And then instead, block party. You're trying not to laugh.
You're going to the well.
I can see it in your eyes.
You're going to the well way too often.
I can see it in your eyes. We got blocked by him.
Adrian Stroop.
Stroop.
Hey, friendos. For some reason, I find myself actually caring about Baron Corbin versus Jack Swagger.
I have no idea why.
It just seems fresh to me. I can't explain why.
He seems like he's having real problems with this, too.
Well, he says,
I don't know why. I have no idea why.
He says for some reason.
It's really bugging me now.
It's inexplicable.
Yeah. Block party.
How does this program go? Where do you think it gets either of these guys coming out of it?
Oh, man.
I mean, Baron Corbin's going to win.
Look at Baron Corbin and how he's destroying Apollo Crews' head on the barrier. That's where Jack Swagger's headed, because Jack Swagger is not as leveled up as Apollo Crews. He comes out, talks about, it's Rolling Stones! And everybody literally, it was last week, it was promo.
Yeah, everybody
was like, what?
No one got the reference.
Morrow was like, what the hell was that? Block party!
Greg P., got some Twitter questions here.
Yeah.
Do you guys think there is a worse gimmick right now than Curt Hawkins? Even though we haven't seen him, he makes me cringe.
No, that's it. That's the worst.
Why in the promo?
It's so bad.
Why in the promo tonight was he employing different voices?
I don't know. I didn't recognize any of the voices. I have no idea. It's so.
It's just the Chuck Norris jokes from 15 years ago.
It reminds me of either like 2000. WCW when they would do stupid stuff like this.
Yeah.
Or like 1993 WCW. In any event, it reminds me of WCW. That's never a good thing.
Yeah.
Curt Hawkins. Curt Hawkins.
I don't get it.
It's a fact. You're blocked.
CJ
Shuchik?
Okay. Do you expect WWE to utilize more matches like cage matches, table, ladders, falls count anywheres? It's been a while for them. Well, there's a cage match on Raw Monday.
That's true.
If they used them all the time, they wouldn't be as special.
I feel like they use them.
Yeah, I think they use them
plenty. I feel like they use them plenty.
Yeah, just the right amount.
This guy plays too much of the video game, man. Every match he does is like a gimmick match.
Could be.
He's like, this is how it should be.
Yeah.
CJ says, you need all these. He's like, hey, listen, I got an idea. Listen up, this CJ talking now. I got an idea at the cage match, but there's a table in there and a ladder on top of the table, on top of the cage, and you can pin anybody anywhere.
That's quite the gimmick match.
Yeah, it is.
Michael Mata. If any superstar, any company in era mentioned going in Raw in a shoot, who would have nice things to say and who would say the worst?
Well, you know who has bad things to say about going in Raw? Block party! Oh, no! Troglodyte! Twitter! Bye, Felicia! Straight out of Compton. 2015. Harley Quinn is a suicide of the girls of the Suicide Squad.
Jeez.
Of the women's division.
All right.
He'd have the in a shoot. He's like, one day I got off SmackDown and I checked my Twitter. 500 people voted in a poll. I said, it's awkward. Block party. That'd be his shoot. And he's like, well, I spilled some ketchup on me. So who would have some good things to say about us? Any superstar mentioned going in or on a shoot, who would have nice things to say? I would think Enzo would have good things to say. We chatted him up quite friendly.
Yeah.
At the old thing, the thing that we did.
Yeah, that's
good. Nice things to say about us.
Pixel.
A couple of haters came over. They were like, "Hey, what should we eat?"
Yeah.
Block party.
If you're new to New York, that's a good question.
I think so. Continue.
Pixelated junk. Yeah. Do you think AJ would have become champ if Finn was champ on Raw? Maybe that's why the club has been put on the shelf at the moment.
Do you think AJ would? Yeah. Who said recently? I think one of the – maybe it was on Jericho's podcast. I need to listen to Jericho's podcast when he brought on the club.
Yeah.
He had Gallows and Anderson. And I think one of them said – God, I'm not going to say that. I read somewhere somebody was saying, shit, for all I know, this is an article I read. There's nobody related to the WWE. But they were talking about the idea that, let me ask you this, if you agree with this. The brand split up AJ and the club to benefit the club. That it was necessary for the brand split for them to get to the point where they're at. I don't necessarily disagree with that, though. When I read it, I was like, oh, okay, I'm not terribly
like Gallows and Anderson had to go on their own to reach the point where they're at.
So they didn't. Beyond. We know that they could have just continued to do the same thing. But to constantly be AJ's insurance policy, his words, as opposed to being their own thing.
Yeah.
I could see how a perception might view it that way, perhaps.
Mm.
I don't necessarily agree with it, but I don't disagree with it either.
Yeah.
You know, if they wanted to go one way.
I think until reality bears that out.
Well, another point to consider as well is that if they're on the same brand where one goes, the other act has to go.
Yeah.
You would think. If AJ turns heel or face, the other two should do it as well. I mean, yeah, you can do a story, but I don't know. If they had big plans for AJ Styles on a singles run, shedding the weight of the club.
Yeah, well, I definitely see how that can benefit AJ because since they've been split up.
No more crutch and he's booked strong.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I can definitely see how it benefits AJ.
Yeah.
Ryan Montana. Hey, friendos.
Ryan Montana.
If you could repackage any wrestler from
Montana
Raw
cigarettes.
Or SmackDown, who would
smoke
it be
them now.
And how would you do it?
If you could repackage any wrestler from I love that name, Ryan Montana.
Yeah, it's good.
If I can repackage any wrestler from either Raw or SmackDown, who would be able to do it? I tell you what, they're just repackaged the Usos, and they're amazing now.
Yeah.
They're legit.
Yeah.
They're like the Briscoes. They're not quite like the Briscoes. But that's what I was sort of reminded of when they came backstage and started, like, Jack and Rhino for his crackers. They just reminded me. They had, like, a Briscoes vibe. Like, they were completely in their character.
Yeah.
And they were comfortable in it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Clayton C. Since the reign of Dog Ziggler's Colonel Sanders has come and gone,
Dog Ziggler,
what superstar would you recast as a fast food mascot?
Oh, what a great question.
That is a great question.
I would do this. You know what I would really actually like to see? Because so KFC's doing that thing where they rotate the Colonel a lot.
Yeah.
And I love that. I'm going to keep going with that. I would love to see Baron Corbin as the Colonel.
Okay.
That'd be great. I was originally going to say John Cena, but then Baron Corbin popped in mind. That'd be good.
I was thinking Rusev is the Hamburglar.
Oh, I like that a lot. That's really good. Yeah.
That'd be good.
That was a good one. I'm trying to think. Hi, I'm Ryan Montana.
The Iron Man, Mackenzie Krieger.
Where are you getting these additional questions from?
From the email.
Yes!
What are your thoughts on the Usos' new ring gear? I like that I can finally tell them apart, seeing as they got rid of the paint. Would you consider face paint a baby-faced thing? I just realized I can't think of any wrestlers that were heels with face paint other than Goldust, but I feel like he was just misunderstood more so than a straight-up heel.
That's a good point. Boogeyman. But that was more like makeup. Well, that was face paint. Boogeyman was a heel, I think. Well, Gallows...
The Ascension.
I don't know. I mean, I guess the Bullet Club was considered tweeners, or are considered tweeners, sort of, in New Japan. But Gallows wore face paint in New Japan. I wish he'd wear it again. It was dope. Tama Tonga over there, he wears face paint. He looks rad. Mm-hmm. He looks amazing. I don't know. I've never really thought about it as being strictly a babyface thing, but I guess I can't really think of any good examples of heels.
The Ascension, they're heels.
That's true. They wear face paint. Good point.
Chops. Why does WWE creative hate Zack Ryder? Why can't they give the man a tag team partner?
It's beyond me too, man. I have no idea. It's bizarre.
Chandler 3 Productions. Hello, friendos. Is it me or why does the SmackDown Women's title match seem lacking? I like Becky Lynch and trying to like Alexa Bliss, but to me, this match seems like so lackluster. I'm actually really excited for it.
Yes.
I think this would be a good match.
No, I'm down for it. I like it. It's new blood, man. It's Alexa Bliss, new blood.
Najee polls. Do you guys think the Usos look like a stable that Kanye West could manage? Or is it just me?
Well, no. The last week, I think it was, they came out in the gear that kind of looked like Kanye's zombie apocalypse line.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I can see that. And they've got, you know, he sort of walks around a lot with that scowl. I think Kanye is like probably a fun-loving guy. He just likes to scowl when media's around. And I get the same thing from the Usos. They're probably hella fun to hang out with.
Oh, yeah. I mean, on Total Divas, they both seem like fun, funny guys.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think you're right about that.
Yeah.
One more.
Yeah. Yes, block party! One more time! You know, yeah, I know you can keep a straight face, but I know you're
hardcore champion Jericho Kunzman.
There we go.
Hey, friendos.
Hi.
I want to let you guys know that I appreciate listening to you when I'm working.
Oh, that's good.
And who you're looking forward to play in WWE 2K17.
Who are you looking forward to playing?
Ty Dillinger.
Yeah. I am looking forward to playing as custom created character.
Yeah, that too.
In my career mode and in fuck wrestling. I mean, this is what I was sort of thinking. Like, you know, there are certain wrestlers that we have affinities for. Lex Luger.
Oh, man.
What?
I think it's announced that Eddie Guerrero is going to be a DLC character.
Nice.
2K17.
Fantastic.
Awesome.
Eddie Guerrero. There's your answer.
Yeah.
Eddie versus really fast Rey Mysterio, Halloween Havoc, 1997. That's what I want to play as.
All right. We have one more Twitter question.
Okay.
From D. How can they still let Ziggler use the Famouser, but won't let Rollins use the curb stomp?
Well, the back of the knee, you can't really apply the same level of pressure as, like, literally your foot.
Yeah.
And you're getting up way higher, so you can't control where you're stomping with the Famouser. And the guy's going up from further up, so he has more time to sort of brace his fall.
Yeah.
So there's a couple different elements there. I see his point. Still, you have the same basic movement of face to floor.
Yeah.
But curb stomp just looks so much more vicious. Mm-hmm. And to Seth Rollins' point of not wanting to see kids do it on the playground,
yeah.
How many kids do you know can reach a friggin' Famouser?
Not very many.
Not very many.
It's not many wrestlers that can probably do it.
Exactly. So, like, you know, curb stomp's easy. You know, the guy's just leaning down, you jump up.
Yeah.
Curb stomp. So, let's answer your question. Hope we answered your question right. Block party! I got to do some more research on this Mauro Ranallo business.
Oh, goodness.
That's all right. We always talk shit about him anyways. I do anyways. So that's okay. I'm fine being blocked by him. I don't feel
okay.
Too bad.
Okay.
I praise. Look, man, I give credit where credit's due. And if certain people can't handle constructive criticism from me or the 500 people who voted in a poll, then you're blocked. I'm going to block him. Block party.
Okay.
I can do that?
You can do it.
It's our Twitter account. It's Real Going In Raw, though. You're cool with it? You're cool with it?
I don't know.
You don't know?
We'll discuss it later. I don't know. I don't want to think about it.
Discuss it later? Just give me a yes or no right now.
I don't know.
Yes. We're supposed to have, show me some solidarity against Mauro Ranallo. No? Nothing? Oh. Block party. Anyways, that's it for Going In Raw. I want to say thank you to everybody for hitting that download button, subscribe button, and for writing reviews and for voting in our polls on Twitter.
So thank you very much, everybody.
Until next time, we'll talk to you guys later.
Bye.
Block party!
It's old now.
No, it's not.